William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Christmas Guest, a novella by Peter Swanson, performed by Esther Wane. For two aunts, Pearl Taylor Moynihan, who disliked Christmas, and for Sue Ellis Swayze, who doesn't particularly like it either.
"I wear the chain I forged in life," replied the ghost.
Charles Dickens, A Christmas Carol. 1. Since I have no family of my own, I am yearly asked by friends and colleagues to their homes for the Christmas holidays. I always say no, pleading my case that I am perfectly content to be alone for a week. And mostly I am. I read a good book, maybe re-watch some of my favourite films. On Christmas Day, I roast a chicken and eat it with crispy potatoes and Brussels sprouts. My cat, Elspeth, likes a bit of roast chicken too, and I let her sit on the kitchen counter as a special treat. In the afternoon, I often clean my apartment or reorganise my bookshelves. Sometimes, if the weather is nice, I'll take a walk across Manhattan, see if there is a movie playing that looks interesting. I am not completely alone. The doorman Howard and I usually find time for a glass of whiskey, and I have a close friend, also without family, who often drops by, although she hasn't for the past couple of years. This year, Christmas Day has arrived on the heels of a wet, sleety nor'easter that rattles the windows of my apartment. So after my roast chicken, I decide to skip the walk and tackle my bedroom closet. I am lucky enough to live in a two-bedroom apartment, and I'm slightly embarrassed to say that I've turned the second bedroom into a walk-in closet. But I work in fundraising, and sometimes I feel as though half my life is spent at galas and cocktail parties. I need a lot of dresses and a lot of shoes. The closet in my bedroom has become my default storage space, filled with boxes containing mementos of my past lives. All that bric-a-brac that is impossible to throw away, and yet completely useless. I open the door gingerly, expecting an avalanche of photo albums and souvenirs to tumble out. That would make for quite a New York story. Lonely single woman crushed to death while cleaning closet on Christmas Day. Cat kept alive by remaining roast chicken dinner. But the boxes stay aloft long enough for me to remove them from the closet one by one and place them on the floor. My goal is to throw away maybe a quarter of what I've kept. I start with a box that I must have filled during my first few years in New York City. I find a packet of photographs that chronicle a New Year's Eve party in the East Village, worth keeping, and a DVD box set of Seinfeld seasons 1 and 2 that goes directly in the trash. I tell myself this is going to be easier than I thought. By the time I've turned on the lamps in my apartment, I've been through almost all the boxes and filled 2 small trash bags. I'm working on the oldest boxes now, including one that smells like mothballs and contains my grandmother's purse, and another that has a childhood doll I'm loath, for some reason, to throw out. Underneath my birth certificate and my cancelled passports, I find an immediately recognisable diary. White moleskin with a ribbon bookmark, and pick it up, scooching backward along the Persian rug to rest against my bed. I flip through the pages, arriving at an entry from December 1989, exactly 30 years ago. I decide to take a look, not entirely sure that I'm prepared to go back in time to that annus horribilis, that murderous year, but also knowing that once I start to read, I won't be able to stop. There is a famous quote, the first line from L.P. Hartley's The Go-Between, a book about remembering. Although every book is a book about remembering, isn't it? "The past is a foreign country. They do things differently there." In my case, the past really is a foreign country. And yes, they do things very differently there.
December 17th. Emma Chapman, the one who looks like me,
has invited me to her house for Christmas. I tried to be cool and pause for 5 seconds, pretending to consider my options, but I don't think I fooled her. So I just went ahead and accepted, and she looked pleased. She told me that it would be her parents, who were Satan's spawn, her twin brother, who was basically nice, plus a host of friends and endless cousins. Not too many, she said. I know I've mentioned Emma to you, dear diary. Met her during orientation week. Wears cashmere and jewelry that looks like stuff I'll never in my lifetime be able to afford. Sounds posh, or at least that's what other students say. Every time we talk, I say something stupid that I end up repeating in my head again and again. And then there was that time when she told me that she liked Stuart Montgomery, and I forgot about it and hooked up with him and felt awful. In other words, I just assumed she hated my guts. I mean, she was always friendly, but I thought she was just being English. But now that she's invited me to her house for Christmas, who knows? Am I her best friend? I asked her how big her house was, and she said, "Don't worry, I'd have my own room." I had so many questions, but she'd invited me between classes, and there wasn't time to ask them. She said she was chuffed I could come, and that she'd be at the pub in the Union tomorrow night. And if I met her there, she'd give me all the details. I'm excited! Chuffed, I guess, is the correct word. And even though I'd prepared myself to be alone in London over Christmas, part of me even looking forward to it, I am now so happy that I'm going to be with people. Nervous, too, though. What will a family be like? Are my clothes nice enough? Will they expect me to go grouse hunting? Do I need to bring presents? I guess I'll find out everything tomorrow. December 18th. Today was not a good day. I pretty much know that I flunked my British landscapes exam. My brain was frozen all during it, and afterward I double-checked the textbook and I'd misidentified a Turner painting as a constable. So there was that. I went back to my flat in the afternoon and Jody had left all her breakfast dishes on the table. I considered moving them to her bedroom, but decided against it. She's gone in 2 days, and I'll never see her again, so what difference does it really make? Still, it put me in a foul mood. Then I went to the pub, expecting to see Emma, and I figured if anything could cheer me up, it would be that. I couldn't wait to hear more about our Christmas holidays. But I sat at a table by myself for an hour, and she didn't show. I was about to leave when Tom, that kid from Florida who always wears a baseball cap, showed up, and I had a few drinks with him. Told him how I wasn't going back to America for the Christmas break, and he just kept asking me why. And finally, probably because I'd had about 6 ciders, I told him that my mom was dead, and I didn't know who my father was, so I was basically an orphan. I hadn't wanted to tell him because I thought he'd be full of pity, and I wasn't in the mood for it. But it turned out he was pretty rude about my orphan status, saying something like, "You must have friends, though, right?" I told him I had friends, thinking of Michelle, so in love now with her college boyfriend that I barely hear from her. Wah! I did let him walk me back to my flat, and he reminded me about that party back in September when we'd fooled around, and I said that I'd grown up a lot since then. "Ha ha," he said, and tried to kiss me anyway. But honestly, I wasn't in the mood. I had a pretty decent memory of the time we'd fooled around, and it hadn't exactly been pleasant. Neck liquor, for one, and his shirt smelled. I went up to my flat, where I could hear Jody fucking that professor from her program, and I clopped as loudly as I could into the kitchen, ate a bowl of leftover mashed potatoes, and while I didn't wash the dishes she'd left on the table, I gritted my teeth and put them into the sink to soak in warm water. Then I got into bed and wrote to you, dearest diary. December 19th. It's morning, and I'm still under the covers. All I have to do today is turn in the essay I've already written on art in Weimar, Germany, and then meet with my advisor, Nicola. It's occurred to me that I could try to find Emma. I'm pretty sure that she'll be taking her last exam today in Somerset House, and I could skulk around outside and hope to run into her. But maybe she's decided she doesn't want me to come home with her for Christmas after all. And if that's the case, then it'll just be embarrassing for both of us. I was resigned to being alone in London already, so I'll just have to become resigned again. I'll go to all the museums I haven't gone to yet. I'll do the student standby thing and go to the theater. And if it's not too cold, I'll try to start running again. Michelle told me I would gain about 20 pounds when I lived in London, and honestly, she wasn't that far from the truth. Less cider, no more potatoes, more running. Go back to the Leighton house and pay attention this time. Eat at that Indian place with the blue walls again. And who knows, maybe get a head start on my coursework for next semester. That would be amazing. The more I think about it, the more I think it's best that I'm alone over Christmas. It'll be good for me. Well, I'm back, and I'm just a little bit drunk, and I've spent all night with Emma, and not only am I going to her family's house in the Cotswolds, but I'm going tomorrow! After I met with Nicola, and she assured me that I had definitely not flunked British landscapes, I went straight to the Dragon, which was packed, of course, because it was last day of term. Debbie and Tom and that other American girl whose name I can never remember were all there, and I had drinks with them. And then I saw Emma up at the bar, and I didn't know what to do, but she turned and saw me and ran over to tell me how sorry she was that she didn't make it the night before, and how she realized she didn't have my number or anything. Short story long, she told me that it was all settled for me to come to her house, but that she couldn't give me a ride. She was totally embarrassed, I think, but her brother was driving her home tonight. He lives in London, too, and she would have invited me to go with them, but my room wasn't ready yet, and Mummy had said no visitors till Wednesday, and etc., etc. And would I mind taking the train tomorrow afternoon, and she'd pick me up at the station? I told her that I'd love to take the train, and she hugged me and got my number at the flat, and told me she'd call me in the morning with the train time and all that. I kept asking her questions about what I should wear and what I should bring, and she kept laughing and told me to wear whatever I want and don't bring anything, which wasn't helpful. Then she put her hand on my cheek and stared into my eyes and told me how excited she was that I'd be there for Christmas. And I realized she was pretty drunk too. Hopefully she'll actually call tomorrow. December 20th. I'm on the train to Cleavemore. It hasn't moved yet, so I'm still at Paddington Station. But I can't believe I'm actually going to an English country house for Christmas. It sounds like the beginning of a romance novel. Or else maybe a murder mystery. Either one is far better than staying in London and getting lonely and depressed. Emma called me in the morning. She said she was calling from Starvewood Hall, and I said, "Your house has a name?" And she laughed and told me that most houses in the country had a name and not to be too impressed. She had looked up train times and told me that I could catch a 1:35 from Paddington that would go direct. She said that she'd either pick me up herself or she'd send her brother. I asked her again what to bring, and she said nothing. Still, this morning, I went on a manic shopping spree, buying two new pairs of tights, a white cable knit sweater, a new headband that doesn't smell as though I haven't taken it off for 2 months, and some new underwear because you never know. Then I went to the body shop and bought foot creams and lotions to give to Emma and maybe her mum. Then I panicked about the brother and her father and wound up going to a liquor store and spending practically all the money I have in the world on a bottle of scotch that the man in the shop told me was gift-worthy, and on a bottle of port that had a pretty label. My bag weighs a ton, but I'm on the train and it has actually started moving. Except for the tube, I haven't been on a train while living here, and I thought I might be in one of those cabins you see in the movie with a glass door, everyone smoking. But I'm on an upholstered two-seater facing the wrong way, and the man next to me smells like onion soup. The fabric on the seats is the crazy pattern of blues and golds. The oniony man has fallen asleep, his shoulder pressed up against mine. The train has cleared London, and while there's no actual blue showing in the sky, it isn't raining or snowing. And 5 minutes ago, I saw a flock of sheep on the side of a hill. I can't quite believe this is my life. A year ago, I was in California, probably about to take the bus to my cousin's house in Carbondale, feeling sorry for myself, feeling like my life was never going to change. But it did change, and I'm on this train, and Emma said I should stay a whole week at least, that there was the dearest country pub walking distance from the house, and that at least one of her cousins was semi-cute. I asked her what everyone did during the week, and she told me that what she did all day was read books or take country walks. She said it rather more charmingly, something like, "Oh, be lazy, get fat, walk to the end of the garden and back, start drinking at lunch."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.